First session of the health law policy and an ethics seminar series, which has, as you may have seen, a new name. It's now called the Mary and Philip Seaman Health Law Policy and Ethics Seminar Series, because we received a very gracious donation of the family, the Seaman family, one of whom, Neil Seaman, is a former student of the law school, and very interested in promoting health law activities at the law school. So we're very gracious for that contribution to the seminar series, which will allow us to organize also a couple of special events. You may have received already the schedule for the fall. There will be the same number of events in the winter term, maybe even some events during the summer, as a result also of the donation that we received. We are very happy and very honored to have as a first presenter Bill Bogart, who will be speaking about regulating cannabis, a prelude to legalizing all recreational drugs. It's a very important, very timely topic, and we're very happy that he was available to come and present here. So we also are very honored to have Akwasi Owusu-Bempah as a commentator, as well as, at the last minute, Nathalie Derosier, a member of parliament of the legislature, who you may have seen or heard or read about her intervention with respect to the invoking of the notwithstanding clause in parliament in the last couple of days, in the turmoil around the Ontario government's intervention. So let me briefly introduce Bill Bogart, Akwasi Owusu-Bempah, and then Nathalie Derosier, and then I'll give the word to Bill. So Bill is a former student actually at the University of Toronto, did his LLM at Harvard, is a distinguished university professor and professor of law at the University of Windsor, from which he retired. He has held several SHRC and other research grants to support his research, has been a scholar in residence for the Law Commission of Canada, has been a frequent consultant to government, and has authored eight books. The last three have been on regulation of consumption, so related to the topic of today. Book on permit but discourage regulating excessive consumption, the second one also on food-related issues, regulating obesity, government, society, and questions of health. And the last one, off the street, legalizing drugs. He writes frequently for the Huffington Post and comments also frequently in the media, and is working on a new book, O Canada, a Calm Nation in a Turbulent World. I would say the last couple of days, it doesn't suggest that we're so calm, but...
Well, I'd emphasize that the subtitle has a question mark at the end.
Okay. So the second person, the person who will first comment is Akwasi Owusu-Bempah. He's an assistant professor in the Department of Sociology at the University of Toronto. Dr. Owusu-Bempah's work focuses on the intersection of race, crime, and criminal justice, with a particular interest in the area of policing. He's currently studying various aspects of cannabis legalization in Canada. His research has recently been published in Policing and Society, Crime and Justice, and Theoretical Criminology. Then last but not least, we have, very happy to have Nathalie Derosier, who is a member of the Provincial Parliament for Ottawa-Vanier. She was the Dean of the Faculty of Law of the Common Law Section at the University of Ottawa. Her areas of expertise are constitutional law and women's rights. She served as the General Counsel for the Canadian Civil Liberties Association, and in this capacity has certainly dealt with issues related to the legalization of drugs. In her capacity as a counsel, she appeared in front of Parliament, various legislative bodies, to defend the rule of law and constitutional protections. And the CCLA is also, as many of you know, an intervener in front of all levels of courts in Canada. So without further ado, Bill.
Thank you so much, Trudeau, and thanks to the Seaman family for their very generous support of health issues in our society. It's a real pleasure to be here with you, and really a pleasure to have Akwasi and Natalie come in. I was delighted to hear that they would be joining the panel. I would like to start by indicating that I have received no money for the shaping of my views regarding cannabis and legalization, either from the private sector or the public sector. My wife and I are investors, however, we hold no shares in cannabis companies, either in terms of production, distribution, or whatever. So I'm going to keep this brief because I definitely want to hear from Akwasi and Natalie, and I'm very interested to hear your reaction because the legalization of cannabis is the stuff of daily life, isn't it? It's in the media almost on a daily, sometimes frequently on a daily basis. And I think most folks do have a reaction to what's going on. And of course, people who've come to this health law seminar, I think, would have a very interesting questions and comments. So I'm anxious to hear them and respond and do whatever will be of interest. So I will talk about how we got here, then I'll talk about why we got here, and then I'll say something about where's here. And then I'll allude to three overarching issues that remain. And then I do want to raise the possibility of the legalization of and regulation of cannabis as a kind of prelude to facing the, I believe, much bigger and much more difficult issue of legalizing and regulating all recreational drugs. All right, how we got here? Well, I think that the failure of the war on drugs was a very important backdrop. Over the last several decades, increasingly, people have come to recognize that the war on drugs was, generally speaking, a failure. It did not achieve its fundamental objective, that is, of suppressing the use of illicit drugs. The legal drugs, alcohol and tobacco, was somehow treated very differently, even though, of course, they had their dangers. And beyond that, the war imposed very significant collateral costs. It criminalized people simply because they were using a drug. It ruined their lives in terms of employment prospects. Sometimes they were incarcerated. It gave rise to a huge national, international illicit market that paid no taxes, that cared nothing for quality assurance, so distributed drugs that were tainted, that could sicken people or even kill them. It prevented any kind of harm reduction efforts, and by harm reduction I mean that an acknowledgement that people do use drugs and then taking measures to do whatever we can to minimize the harm that arises from can arise from a drug taking. I'll say more about harm reduction later on. And then, of course, the exploitation of individuals who get caught up in the drug trade, and first and foremost, children, who have, in many ways, been horribly affected and exploited in many societies, including our own. So with that sort of a waning confidence in the war of drugs, I think attention became focused on the most popular of the illicit drugs, and cannabis is the drug that is most, the illegal drug that is most widely used. And you will have seen, I guess it's in the book, Off the Street, a recounting of the efforts at least decriminalized cannabis over the decades. The moment arrived, however, with the 2015 election. Liberals grasped the nettle and made legalization regulation a plank in their platform, and as we all know, the Liberals won, and Justin Trudeau became the Prime Minister. And he did what many politicians do in these circumstances. He appointed a special task force to look into the prospect of legalization and regulation. I think it's very important to point out the mandate of that task force was how to regulate it. The question, they were not to entertain the question of should it be legalized and regulated. That was a foregone conclusion. Their mandate was focused on how it would, should be regulated. They reported in December 2016, there was some 80 recommendations. Strictly speaking, their mandate was confined only to the federal level, but clearly their recommendations had some implications for the provincial role and the municipal role. We'll talk about the sort of tripartite roles, federal, provincial, and municipal, in a moment. So that then brought us to 2017, and in the spring of 2017, the Liberal government, federal Liberal government, introduced its legislation. And that legislation was very closely scrutinized in the House of Commons during the spring of 2017 into the fall of 2017. It passed, I believe, in November. And then in the winter of March 2018, the Senate set to work to scrutinize the bill, and again, I think very close scrutiny was looked at by several committees. There were moments of tension between the House of Commons and the Senate, and it looked for a while that there might be something of a political crisis brewing, but things got smoothed over. Not that smooth, but they did get smoothed over. The legislation of cannabis is actually a good case study in the evolving role of the Senate in this country. But that's, you know, that's an aside. In any event, at the federal level, things got settled out. Meanwhile, beginning about the fall of 2017, the provinces and territories set to work. And of course, that was a more complicated scenario because all the provinces. Each of the provinces and territories could go their own way in terms of their role. And the role is coming to the point primarily in terms of retail sales. And so we saw a kind of split between a very private model where in retail sales would be regulated by the government, but the cannabis would actually be sold by and large by the private sector. And that's sort of Alberta and Manitoba, and then we had a much more private, public model, and I think the clearest example of that was on Ontario. There were to be about 80 to 100 brick and mortar stores. There would be sales online, but they would be owned and controlled by the government. Now, as you know, there's been a huge wrinkle in one because of the Conservatives coming to power. And at last note, Premier Ford said, no, forget it, we're not doing the government thing. We'll do the private thing, but we're not going to do it until the spring of 2019. So meanwhile, we get out of the starting gate in terms of legalization regulation, October 17th, Ontarians will access cannabis online. So it was, you know, we're going to see how that goes, and you may have some questions or comments about that. So why did we get here? Why did we make this, you know, fairly significant shift in terms of consumption of this drug? And I think, again, the war on drug was very important backdrop for all the reasons that I stated initially. But there were very special reasons around cannabis that came to the fore that I think kept pushing us on. One of which was differential impact on minorities, or as the New York Times said in an editorial, smoking while black. that the evidence was in the United States and here that although minorities, visible minorities, did not necessarily use this drug with any greater frequency than white individuals, and sometimes with less frequency, they were charged in much greater numbers. And I believe Akwasi will have some things to say about that, both in terms of what was occurring during Prohibition and what the scenario might look like on a go-forward basis. A related issue was the differential in charging rates. So, for example, if you lived in Halifax, you had sort of a high teen chance of being charged if the police found you with cannabis on your possession. This would be for personal use. Whereas in Saskatchewan, if they caught you, the charging rates were something like 85%. So that was a very significant difference. And there were a couple of, you know, quite rigorous study over several years demonstrating this very significant discrepancy. And, you know, I think this is rule of law stuff. I mean, you can't have criminal sanctions being applied to individuals in a very, very differential way. Another factor, I think, was the growing recognition of the relative harmlessness of cannabis, which is not to say that it's a harmless drug. I mean, kids should not be using it with any regularity. Pregnant women should be very cautious about it. There's obviously issues around drug-impaired driving. But that sort of brouhaha, reefer madness that we lived with for many decades, you smoke a couple of joints and you're going to become deranged, clearly was recognized to be just fallacious, that the drug can be used in moderation without untoward impact, and certainly compared with the dangers of legal drugs, alcohol and tobacco. I mean, the dependency rates for alcohol are about 80%. The chronic toxicity rates, of tobacco, the chronic toxicity rates of tobacco are, as you know, very, very significant. Yet another factor was the coming of medical marijuana, which was legalized by court action about 15 years ago. And, there's lots of urban legend around the therapeutic impact of cannabis, and it has to be studied much, much more rigorously. But the fact of the matter is, the legalization of medical marijuana and the regulation of it and the provision of it by government authorities showed us that the framework was there. You could regulate this drug. It could be done. And then I think very importantly was the public embrace of this drug. You know, especially amongst those of elevated socioeconomic status, it became a matter of quite public use. So, for example, Toronto Life in March 2016, so this is before the a task force had reported, federal task force, had a whole issue on just, what to pair various strains with in terms of eating and how you might enjoy and all this stuff. Now, I have to say, this appears in the introduction of the book. This drives me crazy. I can't stand this stuff, right? So this notion that you would, spend time trying to pair various strains with various dishes strikes as being completely out there. I always say just because you don't use a drug doesn't mean that you can't support a shift away from prosecution and criminalization and incarceration of those who do. But the point here, I think, is with this growing public acceptance, and the polls showed that the percentages who are open to legalization and regulation just kept going up and up over the last 10 years. And then finally, I think it was the fact that although Canada will be the first G7 country to legalize and regulate the drug. It is not the first jurisdiction. Uruguay is already off the blocks in legalization and regulation. And as you are aware, several American states have legalized and regulated the drug. However, cannabis remains illegal in the United States at the federal level, and that does cause complications, and we can get into that if you like. All right, so where is here? Where did this all get us? And I discussed this in the paper, so just briefly. The here is more or less the way we regulate alcohol and tobacco. There's this sort of divided jurisdiction between the feds and the provinces. And the feds are essentially responsible for quality assurance and production. They have a role in setting of taxes. They do have a role in enforcement through the RCMP. The provinces are primarily responsible for retail sales, with these different models that I talked about. They have a voice in taxation. They collect the taxes. And then they have a huge piece around enforcement because of the provincial, territorial, and municipal police forces. And then, of course, the municipalities, although they don't have any constitutional base, we've come to know that, they will have a huge role in enforcement and education, counseling, so they're quite concerned that they have enough resources to carry out their mandate. Okay, so then that would leave us with these three overarching challenges that I talk about in the paper, and that is non-compliance with international agreements on drug enforcement, issues around harm reduction, and then issues around drug-impaired driving. And I'm just going to sort of skip over that in the interest of time. I will say that my baseline interest here is regulation of consumption, as Trudeau mentioned. So harm reduction is really sort of the area that I'm most interested in, and I'm happy to go on and on about how we're using taxation to try to suppress dangerous consumption, while at the same time worrying about the levels of taxation in the illicit market. So that's one of my sort of favorite topics. So happy to take questions or comments about that. So then, a prelude to legalization and regulation of all drugs. So the arguments for legalizing and regulating all drugs are essentially the same as cannabis and, the war on drugs and the cost it's imposed. And I think it is very important to recognize that legalization of all drugs would essentially take us back to the situation that existed before the 20th century. The criminalization of drugs is essentially a 20th century project. Before the dawning of the 20th century, drugs were more or less freely available. Laudanum, which is opium and alcohol, was taken sometimes as a daily pick-me-up, sometimes for therapeutic uses. Opium was given to babies to soothe them. Morphine, Sears Roebuck advertised morphine kits to better enjoy the wonder drug. I mean, drugs were not seen as even part of the regulatory project, let alone the criminal project. And this criminalization of drugs really occurred in the early part of the 20th century. And it's a long, complicated story, a tale that I tell in Off the Street. It's a dark story. It was driven largely by racism. But the point is that if we go back to legalizing and regulating drugs, this will not be it'll be a break with our recent past, but it will not be a break with our past. Now, that's fine to say, but people say, oh my God, the government's going to start selling cocaine. My child is going to be able to get access to LSD. There's this sort of resistance to supplying drugs. And it is a resistance that I do understand. I've got a chapter on supply issues and Off the Street, and I begin with it by telling the reader I'm a tortured soul in this regard. This is really the difficult part, I think. But I think we're getting there. And what I mean by, we've got prominent think tanks like Transform in England, the Global Commission on Drug Policy, that had such people as Kofi Annan, Ruth Dreyfus, Louise Arbour, and they have very thoughtful and careful reports on moving towards legalization and regulation of all drugs. And you know, look, this, we can do this. This is how we might do it. And we'll have to do it gradually. We'll have to do it thoughtfully. We understand people's apprehensions, et cetera, et cetera. Public opinion is shifting. So the Toronto Public Health Authority did a survey consultation this past July. 3/4 of those asked believe that there needed to be changes in Canada's approach to drugs and that criminalization was not the answer. BC did a poll in December 2016, and 2/3 of those asked said that they would consider legalizing drugs. The city councils of Vancouver and Montreal have called for decriminalization of drugs. I'll get to what criminalization in a moment, as has the Toronto Board of Health. And we've got reports that even the chiefs of police are actually studying decriminalizing drugs. So that, where's the shift going to take place? And I think it will first take place around decriminalization. So just let's just remind ourselves of the distinction. Decriminalization only speaks to the demand side. It says that if you have drugs on your person for your own personal use, you will not be charged criminally. Okay? But it doesn't speak to the supply side. You still have to go to the illicit market. There's still no quality assurance. Taxes aren't collected. The illicit market can be run by the underworld, et cetera, et cetera. Now, what's the evidence that decriminalization would be a step forward? Well, Portugal. Portugal, about 15 years ago, essentially decriminalized all drugs. And that experiment, because all of this is an experiment, so policy is always an experiment, has been intensely studied. And the results, I think there's largely consensus around the results. I mean, rates of HIV infection went down. Rates of overdose by drugs went down. There was no spike in drug use, especially in terms of kids. Portugal has not become a haven for drug tourism. In other words, people going just to take drugs. Norway has just decriminalized drugs, so we'll be looking very, very closely at Norway. What's driving the sense of desperation that we have to do more is the opioid crisis, right? And you know, the Globe and Mail just this week said, look, this thing is not under control. Last year, more people died of drug overdoses in BC than motor accidents, suicide, and murders combined. Right? This is a plague. It is spreading. Your mother could die of an overdose. Your brother could die of an overdose. Your neighbor could die of an overdose, right? These are people that are caught up in something. There are reasons, there are different reasons why, but they, you know, increasingly people are recognizing that why would we arrest people and threaten them with jail when they're caught up in something? What we need to do is save their lives, right? And so the focus really has become on decriminalization, and there's really a tension now between the federal government and advocates and health professionals who want to move in this direction. Now, I think, you know, we want to say immediately, it's not like the feds haven't done anything. They're very open to opening safe injection sites. They're helping in the spread of naloxone, which is this opioid inhibitor. They passed the Good Samaritan law, so if you call somebody in the middle of an overdose and you've been using, you won't be charged. There are main medical grade heroin, which is an opioid, available so that under tightly regulated conditions, physicians can say, look, the only way we can stabilize you until we can get you off these drugs, or maybe we'll never get you off these drugs, okay? Like we have to face this. Some of these people never get off these drugs for various reasons, but we can use medical-grade heroin to stabilize their conditions and to have them move forward and to find a path, as much as a path that they can find, right? And so the feds, in fairness, have done this and other things as well. But, you know, we have not controlled this plague. And so, you know, there's this push to do more, and the push is towards decriminalization. Now, I'm prepared to say that we have to do more than decriminalization, because decriminalization still leaves us without a safe supply of drugs. It's still run by the illicit market. There's no taxation. There's still much stigma attached, et cetera, et cetera. But I think decriminalization is an important first step. I'm going to stop there.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Bill, for your words of insight. I enjoyed reading the paper itself, and of course for your comments today. One of the things you noted was that race and racial disparities and drug arrests were one of the key drivers in our move towards legalization. And while I agree, I find it quite peculiar, largely because we don't have access to any good statistics around the racial background of individuals that are arrested of different crimes generally in this country, or of drug crimes in particular. So we know, for example, in the United States, that Black and Latino people are greatly overrepresented as the targets of the war on drugs. We see that both in terms of the arrest rates. We've certainly seen that in sentencing, not only in sentencing for the same drugs, but the way in which different drugs receive different penalties. And I'm thinking here specifically about the distinction between powdered and crack cocaine. Powder cocaine use was associated with white upper class folks, crack cocaine associated with people of color who lived in inner cities. 1 gram of crack cocaine was to be treated equally by the courts as 100 grams of powdered cocaine, right? 1 gram of crack, 100 grams of powder. I don't know who knows much about drugs, but that's a huge difference. A gram of cocaine can go a fair way. 100 grams would go a long way. So that's a lot of cocaine. And so as an individual that studies like race and injustice, or the impact that race has on individuals' experiences with the justice system, we recognize that, you know, of our social institutions, there are few in which injustice is as apparent as in our criminal justice systems. And the policing of drugs is certainly a key driver of these inequalities. So back to my initial comment, we did have Bill Blair come out when we started this process saying that our indigenous and our marginalized populations have been disproportionately targeted by the war on drugs. He should know this, of course. Not only did he do undercover buys in one of the police divisions here as a junior officer, but he, of course, was the chief of our police service before being tapped to run as an MP and then appointed as Trudeau's drug czar. But as I've noted, we don't have race-based justice data. So unlike the United States or the United Kingdom, our criminal justice system collects data on the racial background of individuals that come into contact with the system, but it in no sophisticated or systematic way analyzes that data, nor does it make it public. So when we're looking at the issues of race and criminal justice, race and justice outcomes, from a federal level anyway, we typically have just one document that includes anything about race, and that's the race of the individuals that are represented in our federal correctional institutions. So this leads to a system where we now have governmental agencies contacting me, because they know I'm an expert in the area, looking at legalization and asking me for data on the rates of individuals that have been arrested in their jurisdiction. So I've had governments from the federal level down, government ministry branches at federal level down, writing me saying, we understand you do research in this area. Can we please have your statistics on the individuals who would have come into contact with our, you know, under our portfolio broken down by race? And I was like, this is kind of silly, because I have to use freedom of information or access to information to get access to data, analyze it, now you want me to give it back to you. We don't have this race-based data largely, I think, because no data, no problem. We know these disparities exist. There's anecdotal evidence that they exist, but without access to them, little action has had to be taken. And so this is extended to our drug policies, policing and prosecutions. We have data from the early 1990s, and certainly things changed when the Toronto Star started its investigations into race and policing generally. And so Jim Rankin of the Toronto Star has done more to advance issues related to race and justice, I think, in this country than anybody else. And he got a hold of Toronto police data on individuals that were arrested and what happened to them after arrest. And we saw very clearly that it was African Canadians that were more likely to be charged with cannabis possession. Importantly, they were less likely to be released at the scene for possession. And we know that that has a number of negative consequences, of course, right? If you're detained before your trial rather than being released, there's a number of things you can't do with it. It's negative. We have this move towards legalization. Myself and some other scholars, as well as some activists, worked with a couple of different news outlets, the Toronto Star again and Vice News, to try and get access to this data in a big way. Jim Rankin at the Star again requested data from the Toronto Police Service. He got access to data from 2003 through 2013, I believe, if I'm correct. And it showed very clearly that black people in Toronto were overrepresented in cannabis arrests, cannabis possession arrests. This despite the fact that research that I've done myself shows that racial groups in this province use cannabis at relatively similar rates. As Bill mentioned, actually, white youth are actually more likely to use, for example, than many of what we would consider visible minorities, specifically East and South Asians. And then Vice News also got a hold of arrest data from coast to coast. Vancouver, Calgary, Edmonton, Regina, Ottawa, Halifax. And what we can see now quite clearly from coast to coast is that our racialized populations are overrepresented in these drug arrests. As we might assume, it's Indigenous people on the west coast and in the prairies, black people in central and eastern Ontario. So in the United States, legalization has been touted as a way to bring around, kind of as a means of social justice. And while I think there is some promise there, we have to be cautious. One of the things we see is that post-legalization or post-decriminalization in the United States, rates of racial disparities actually increase post-policy change. And I'll say that again. After legalization or decriminalization, rates of racial disparities actually increase. Why? Because it's racially discriminatory policing that's a key driver of those arrests. And we see that here in Toronto. So I'll bring back to Bill Blair. When we think about race and policing in the city, we think about Bill Blair and his involvement in the practice of police carding, which I'm sure many of you are aware of. The practice of carding, which is the stopping and documenting of individuals to collect their personal information and for intelligence and informational gathering, was ramped up under Bill Blair. And we saw, with the increase in the practice of carding, also an increase in arrests for cannabis possession. Of course, the more people that you stop and you search, the more likely you'll find, I'm not sure in this room, if I were to ask every single person to open their bags, it wouldn't be a surprise though to take this many people in a room in Toronto and someone have a cannabis product. It might not be leaf, it might be in the form of a vaporizer or some kind of tincture in this day and age, but it's a ubiquitous product, right? So as carding increased, so did the arrest for cannabis possession. Because these police practices are so race-based, so are their targets, right? So while overall numbers of arrests went down in places like Alaska, Washington, D.C., Washington State, Colorado, the police were still targeting or focusing their efforts on racialized populations. And so those populations were more likely to be found in possession of cannabis. So one of the things that I think we need to do now, where are we? Where are we now? What can we do? There are a number of measures, I think, that need to be put in place to repair some of the harms that we know have been done by the war on drugs, right? So even something as simple as a cannabis possession arrest can have a huge impact on an individual's life. Cannabis is often referred to as a gateway drug. I agree. Not a gateway to harder drug use, but a gateway into the criminal justice system, right? An initial arrest, if it doesn't result in a warning, can lead to probation. An individual who gets probation and lives in a highly policed area is more likely to slip up if they're out after curfew, in possession perhaps of alcohol, or in the presence of someone else with a criminal record. And so not only are they then saddled with that initial cannabis possession charge, but then a breach offense, and this becomes cyclical. So there are three things that are largely being proposed. The first is amnesty. The second is the redistribution of tax revenue. And the third is inclusion in this licit market. And I'll go through these relatively quickly. If we know that prohibition was wrong and we know it's had a disparate impact on certain groups, I think it's the least the government can do to erase or clear the records of those individuals that have been harmed, right? This criminal record, as I've said, not only impacts them and their ability to get things like meaningful employment. We now know that police agencies are partnering with large landlords to do criminal background checks on potential tenants, so it can impact housing as well as travel. It hurts them, their families, their communities, and ultimately our society as a whole, right? There might be 500,000 Canadians that have criminal records for simple cannabis possession. And so our economy could be, in a sense, stifled by the inability of those people to work up to their full employment potential. And I was just mentioning, Natalie, that San Francisco's actually done something very cool here. The DA of San Francisco partnered with Code for America to design a machine learning algorithm that actually goes through their charge and conviction records identifies individuals that have been given a conviction for cannabis possession, and then files the paperwork with the court automatically to expunge those records, right? So we don't even have to have individuals do it. We use a novel technology for a good social cause. The second being the redistribution of tax revenue. Under cannabis prohibition, our governments have spent between a half, perhaps, and $1 billion a year policing cannabis. Now, interestingly, this will probably go up in the first years of legalization. There will be more laws surrounding the cannabis plant after legalization than there have been before, right? There will be licit and illicit weed. You can only have so much. You can only grow so much. You can only do certain things with it. But the half a billion to $1 billion is money that's been spent, as I've kind of said before, to harm communities. And there's a move again in the United States to redistribute some of the tax revenue coming from the licit industry. So of course, governments at all levels are eyeing this potential tax revenue. And there's a move to take a portion of this tax revenue to have kind of community reinvestment funds. So we can identify the communities and the individuals that have been most harmed by prohibition simply by looking at the records that we've generated. And even here in Toronto, right, we can identify those neighborhoods down to the block that have been most heavily policed. And individuals like a city councilor in Los Angeles is suggesting that 1% of tax revenues from cannabis sales go to a neighborhood investment fund that would be used to fund things like after-school programs, community centers, local health centers, and the likes. And then importantly, I think there needs to be inclusion in the licit market. So as Professor Borgard has said, he has no interest or stake in any of the listed cannabis companies. That's more than I can say for myself. As an individual who looks like the primary target of the war on drugs, there's absolutely no way that I'm going to sit by and watch, as it happened yesterday, individuals become new cannabis billionaires. I don't know if anyone's been following this, but Tilray broke the NASDAQ four times when set off the mechanism that stops trading volatility. Its share prices increased 1,200% in the last month and a half, up to a market capitalization of $14 or $15 billion US now. There is a lot of money to be made in cannabis. As it stands right now, most of the people who are the targets of the war on drugs are excluded from participation in that industry, either because they have criminal records, and many jurisdictions, including some in Canada, will not allow individuals with criminal records, particularly drug offenses, to participate in the licit market. But secondly, because they come from areas where there are not necessarily a lot of entrepreneurs, they're not well connected, they don't have the connection. We can look at the number of people in the government, right, who are now part of or who have established cannabis companies, not just government, but also former law enforcement officers, right? Julian Fantino, who was the chief of Toronto Police and as a member of parliament, talked all about the perils of drugs, now runs a federally licensed cannabis company out of a jurisdiction north of Toronto. And so the last part of this needs to be a way in which we can fold the people that have been most harmed back into the licit industry. And again, there are some jurisdictions that have done a good job of creating priority licenses for individuals from those jurisdictions. I think I will leave my comments there.
can I just say, that's why I'm a big proponent of people declaring their interests, right? And this is not directed at you, it's directed at the Julia Fantino. Yes. There should be complete transparency, and that's not going on right now.
Absolutely not.
So I'll start with that. I'm not investing in cannabis. And I want to speak, first of all, thank you very much for inviting me. How important this research is, and how important continuing to look at research as supporting good public policy is important. It doesn't look like it that Queen's Park needs research, but it does. Mm-hmm. I am more convinced now that I'm recently in politics that the work that is done is so necessary. So continued, and there's lots of issues. I have a whole list of issues where it could be good research projects and so on, and good questions that continue to be quite relevant. Now, my interest in this area, certainly when I was at the CCLA, we were involved in the medical marijuana cases. Before that, I was the president of the Law Commissioner of Canada, which is the law reform body of the federal government, where I had the pleasure to work with Bill. And we had a project called What's a Crime? And it was essentially to see when is it appropriate to use criminalization as a tool and when it's not. And if I have to say, what does good law reform look like? It looks like this: good questioning, good policy outcomes, then good data, then good evaluation, and then repeat, you know, because you're constantly learning. It always obviously has to adapt to changing notions, new knowledge that gets acquired. The problem with politics and the problem with policy is sometimes we have neither of the three. You know, we have failure on the data collection, biased data collection. Sometimes we actually have very bad evaluation of public policy, and often our policy choices are tinged with political outcome. And it's obvious that the drug area is another area where there is lots of tensions in the public opinion. Politics is the art of timing. You know, you have to capture what people think, move it forward, but if you move too fast or if you do it wrong, it can backfire. You know, sex education would be a good example, for example. So then you're in a backslide position. Now, the history of public policy is a jagged edge. You know, we're hoping that we're overall going in the right direction, but there certainly are setbacks. So how do you insist and continue to have rational discussions about the outcomes of a publicly held public health view of drugs as opposed to a criminalization view of drugs? So let me, I'll start presenting a little bit some of the reflexes that were in the legislature in Ontario. So, full disclosure, I was not part of the Liberal, I was a member of the Liberal Party, MPP, but I arrived late, I'm a latecomer, so I was not really part of the discussion on the drug plan. But essentially, if I had to characterize the Liberal approach, it was permit but discourage, but take whatever legislative framework we have for alcohol, take whatever legislative framework we have for tobacco, whatever the strictest is, let's get it to cannabis, you know. And the reasons why it was explained to us in caucus, I think, is the experience in Colorado and the advice that they were getting is be careful, be cautious. You can liberalize later, but if you start too fast, you could have, like apparently there was in Colorado, an increase of accidents on the road due to cannabis, which created a bit of a backlash, it created kind of some sense of uncertainty about it. So there was this feeling of let's play it safe, let's not go too fast. Now, certainly I think there's also, I think, a great level of uncertainty. It's difficult to have good data when it's an illegal substance. So we would certainly want to have more certainty and more research on the long-term health effects. How do you balance some on, you know, if there are some, what are the cure or what are the ways in which you respond to this? On the law enforcement side, in terms of road safety, we need to know more to know exactly how to manage this. And let me get quickly to the other point. So the new government certainly has a similar approach to as public safety. Their view is that the private market should be there. And I think it has the benefit of probably or so it says, curbing illegal markets, because maybe the price will be lower. So that would be one aspect. But it does, they balance it out a little bit by allowing cities to opt out completely of offerings. And this may have the reverse effect, that is that in some places, the illegal markets may need to be there because they won't be some outlets that will be offered. probably this is a transition thing. Eventually, I suppose most municipalities will allow outlets of cannabis job and so on. So I think that's a transition. It's to make it more palatable to some of their base. But nevertheless, I think we still don't know how they're going to look at the licensing of their private markets. And I hear you about the way in which they will approach the issue of people that were a participant in the illegal market. And I have a private member's bill coming on that I'd like to talk to you. So just very quickly, what are the things that we need to do in terms of research here? Certainly I talked about the demand on health-related research. We need to have a good inventory and a good analysis of the tools of permit and discourage. Certainly, I mean, the great work that you're doing on tax. The way in which there continues to be a myth or about what is the role of availability and accessibility. So many people would say, MAD, for example, comes and says, if it's accessible, the more accessible it is, the more consumption you have. So they were not in favor of liberalizing for alcohol for that reason, and they take the same position here. And many people think it's true, that's the way they feel about their own life, their own choices, you know, about alcohol, about tobacco. So if that's a reality, how are we going to square that? You know, what is the balance between access to the product, public health objectives, you know, controlled access to products so people of a certain age cannot access it, but wanting to curb the illegal markets, you know, how are we going to square that difficulty? So road safety, I've talked a little bit. The other part that's coming very quickly here, and that's it's my last point, is what we call trigger effect of law reform initiatives. So, which means that once you open a box, once you decriminalize, once you then you open a new framework, a new way of thinking. So new research will need to be done on landlord and tenant. You know, I'm sure you've heard, you know, people complaining that in their condo they're smelling, you know, cannabis, and now there's pressure to have new rules on condos. So Landlord and Tenant Act may need to be reopened. Okay. Labor laws, okay, so lots of tensions, you know, will drug testing become more acceptable? Up to now, because it was an illegal substance, you know, there was some restrictions. It had to be a fairly dangerous job and so on. Will that become now routine that people that do any jobs have to endure drug testing? I think the way in which we look at pardon needs to be revisited. I understand the move for amnesty. It's one that I support. I worry that because on the amnesty side, there will be a public opinion that says, it was illegal, mm-hmm. You know, they broke the law. You know, why would we give any amnesty? You know, this idea that they made a choice not to obey the law, and why should we condone that choice? There will be people that will say, now that it's legal, it's you know, it's inappropriate to not give them amnesty for, you know, race-related reason. My fear is that they will carve an amnesty policy that will be very narrow. The only way that you can get the amnesty is you were charged with one offense of illegal possession for yourself. And we know that racialized minorities are always overcharged. You know, so they are charged with a possession for purpose of a traffic. There are, you know, and if the encounter with the police officer doesn't go well, they may be charged with interfering with the police officer and so on. So if the amnesty policy is too narrow, it will just, you know, replicate an entire framework of racialized policing that we've lived through. So so my point is simply this, you know, we need your help. We need really the help of good researchers that continue to think about these, because this is very important. When you have an opioid crisis, when you have a crisis, it precipitates change, legal change, and it can be change for the better or change for the worse. So we need to be vigilant and continue to. And I'm bringing a private member's bill to do two things. Number one, to add criminal information as a ground for human rights protection, hoping that may help on the access to licensing, and also to eliminate criminal record from jury participation. This is a result of the Yakubuchi thing, but it's again to raise. It's only an opener of a conversation if you're on the back bench, but it's to open the conversation about the way in which our criminal justice system has had victims that. Who continue to be unable to work despite the fact that they've paid their debt to society. Yes.
Thank you very much to Bill and to our commentators. This is a seminar that is also taken by students as a course, so students can send me some questions. So please put up your hand if you want to ask a question, but it will start with some of the questions that the students sent me already. And I noticed that there are some questions that are more or less answered in the presentation. So I'll start with some of the questions that I think are.
Can I ask a question?
I'll come to you afterwards. Okay. So I'll read the question. I'll first invite Nara Galustians to ask a question. Okay, Nara. Okay.
Hi. So my original question was in the introductory chapter of your book, you had mentioned the importance of having uniformity across the different jurisdictions when it comes to regulating cannabis. Right now, that's not necessarily the case when it comes to tobacco and alcohol laws. So I'm wondering why that is important, or if I know you addressed the issue of having differences in terms of how people are charged across different provinces and depending on where they live. And I understand that's more the implementation of the law, but do you necessarily think that all laws should be the same across the provinces?
No.
Okay.
Do you think I said that?
So I can read the paragraph I got from.
Meanwhile, can I ask a question, please?
While you're looking for it, and I'm happy to address the specific statements. I mean, I don't think that the provinces should have uniformity, and I don't think that it can happen. I mean, they have a constitutional basis,
right.
And for retail sales, so we can't just impose uniformity.
Right. So I guess from my understanding, it was you say the national government, with cooperation of the provinces, should assert a strong presence both in terms of drafting legislation and in terms of the creation of an oversight agency in order to promote uniformity and coordination throughout the country.
Oh no, but that was my idea that nobody's taken up, which if I ruled the world, which probably isn't a very good idea at all, I would have had an independent regulatory commission.
Okay.
Right? You don't leave it to the politicians. And that one of the mandates of the commissions, both, and you'd have to have some federal workings and provincial working, was to work towards uniformity. Like,
okay.
What are the best practices?
Right.
Okay, but no one seems to be interested in that idea.
Right.
So, whatever its merits, which apparently didn't have any. But can I just say to you, Kwasi, I really like this idea about using the funds for specific ways for reparations. And I think I'm not the only one who argued right from the get-go that taxes should never fall into the general coffers, right? They should be used for specific ends around the legalization and regulation of cannabis, one of which is to drive down the rates of harmful consumption. And obviously the first priority is children. But the whole idea is you would take into account ideas like yours as well.
Yeah, like this is gonna cost more to police and to regulate this, right? all different branches of government are going to have to deal with this. And because there's going to be a substantial kind of revenue stream from this, cannabis, you know, should be paying for itself, right? Like, it should be paying for the law enforcement, it should be paying for the bureaucracy, it should be paying for the public health, and I think a part of what it should be paying for is the repair of the harms done previously.
There's a precedent for this because the gambling.
Yes.
Gambling money as the fund is directed to eliminate or to reduce the harm of gambling. Now, they haven't been completely successful. There's a really an interesting story here about now the casinos give you a card, you know, kind of a preferential treatment. If you spend that much more money, you will get that much more, you know, kind of incentives to gamble more. So there's a little bit of a...
There's a very mixed message there. There's a commercial for the, you know, online casino in your pocket, and then it's like, if you got a problem with the bottom, call us.
Okay, so I'll go to your question, but then I'll turn back to the students. Okay?
The Smoke-Free Ontario Act treats vaping the same way as smoking, as tobacco, lighting up tobacco. And prior to, during the election, Ford, and this is the only positive they had read about Ford, is that he would promise to look at vaping as allow vaping. So what, do you have any comments about that?
Me?
Anybody.
Well, I'll just stick my neck out. I think...
Because we're looking at health care.
Sure, no. And, you know, the big public health story, a big public health story in terms of consumption is how we've driven down the rates of smoking. You know, 30 years ago, plus or minus, we were kissing 50%. We're down now to something like 17%. The real good news story is that we've got it down for kids into single digits. And that's really good news because you don't want a child smoking because they're not adults in small bodies. They're growing intellectually, physically, etc. But also we know that if someone doesn't smoke before the age of 20, they're very unlikely to be a lifelong smoker. So it's very important to get the kids. Now, I mentioned this because now we've got vaping and that's a complication. And there's a sort of divided view about vaping, as I take it because of your question, you're aware of. So some folks say, look.
Healthcare workers.
Pardon me?
To have a patient vaping rather than smoking.
Yeah. So there's a whole school of thought that says, well, you know, vaping is a harm reduction method because it keeps people away from the dangers of tobacco and all the bad stuff. The other school of thought is, well, you know, a lot of these people both vape and smoke, so it just multiplies the effect. You've got a lot of teenagers vaping now. Is it, in fact, in this instance, a gateway? So I think, you know, to get to your point, I think I'm on the school of, when in doubt, err on the side of caution. So I think I probably support this legislation. I know the vapors of the world get angry at me when I say this. Every time I write for the
House. There's a prominent doctor in long-term care who suggests that vaping will not harm the workers around them. And I think it simplifies rather than complicates. Because
and there's
one delivery system for one.
I respect your viewpoint, madam, because as I said, there really is divided opinion here. On the continent and in England, they tend to be in America, they tend to be on the side of restricting vaping. The Federal Drug Administration just came out with some material on the dangers to kids. In England and the continent, they tend to see it more as a harm reduction method. So there is definitely controversy around that.
Well,
right now.
It's a quicker delivery.
Okay, so I'll move to the next person.
Sorry.
Okay. So I have an Anita McCurdy.
It's a quicker delivery. It's faster for pain relief. And I'm talking about older people. I'm talking about people in pain.
Let's go back to the topic of cannabis regulation. So I have Anita McCurman. What has been the response? Was Anita, yes, ask your question.
So my question, you touched on it briefly, but we didn't have time to get into it, which is what's happening on the international level, acknowledging that Canada has international obligations under a few treaties, and I understand there have been some discussions. Do you know what's going on there?
Yeah. I went first last, did somebody else go for, want to go first, or?
No, I was going to say, in one of the triggers, it may open up the way in which we look at the border. You know, I mean, for example, it's about time that we have some border accountability for the guards and so on. It may be that because now there will be some increased scrutiny as to whether people have been part of the industry, it may trigger this. I know your question is not about that. I think many people have suggested that we should just take a stand and try to move the discussion internationally out of its racist origin and just kind of let it go. And I think Canada could be a player in this. So I think there's at two levels. I think there's certainly the conversation in terms of whether international law should be at that level, or where, and Dan, what are you going to do with border crossings?
I agree with that. I would say, and I mentioned in this paper, the wild card is Trump. Mm-hmm. We had a different American administration. You know, I think we might get the line, oh, those crazy socialists up north are at it again. But it's kind of an interesting experiment, so we'll kind of dance with them and, you know, come to some resolution around their contravention of the international covenants. Same with the border. I think, you know, the border could not be the big issue that it seems, you know, it's looming as a very big issue. But, you know, with Trump, you just don't know what's going to happen. And the border already seems to be an issue. It could be an extremely big issue. Like, I could see myself being barred, mm-hmm. right? Because they're going to the computer, and I've got canvas all over me, even though I don't use the drive. But I research and I write about it. So I think, you know, it's not just about what's on paper. It's who are the players. And I'll mention the word Trump and say nothing else.
But there's also some literature, some analysis, legal analysis, suggesting that we're clearly violating the international obligations.
Oh, we are.
And
no, no.
And so that would be an issue on the international scene, how to deal with this.
No, I know, but if we could move to consensus, we could have the kinds of discussion. But with Trump, how likely is that going to, is it going to be?
Well, we could have instruments to...
Yes.
Yeah, like we could have had Trudeau not move so hastily. He could have set this up as a natural social scientific experiment, which wouldn't have violated the international principles. So you can obviously do different things with drugs for the purpose of science. You could have set legalization up as a social scientific experiment mm-hmm. to see what the impacts were mm-hmm. and done it for a period of however long. I think we moved very quickly, and that's why that didn't happen, because of a number of other political blunders. Trudeau wanted something to be a win, and this was an easy one. But I do think, you know, from taking a principal standpoint, this is a great thing for Canada. When you look around the world at the number of other countries that are examining either the decriminalization of drugs, that are introducing medical regimes, like take it back to the, you know, the Canadian cannabis companies, like we've got first mover advantage in terms of having these companies, and they're now creating deals with governments all around the world. So the medical regimes are popping up everywhere, and that seems to be a precursor to legalization in a different way. So, you know, we've got what seems like the end of the war on drugs in some jurisdictions, and even though Trump's Trump in the US, I still think there's, how many American states have legalized or decriminalized cannabis, right? The United Kingdom's looking to do something similar. Not so much the same in certain Asian countries, right? We're seeing an intensification of the war on drugs in some places, but certainly amongst English-speaking Western nations and Western nations generally, I think we're acknowledging that this has been a failure.
Yeah, though if I can just say, Sessions has repealed the Cole Memorandum in the United States. Yeah. Okay, so he's rattled stages. So it's not an assured peaceful terrain.
No.
Christina? Mm-hmm.
I love this so much. It's so interesting. So thank you, all three of you. Okay, something that seems to be coming up in everyone's discussion is this idea that one of the problems that we have is the story around weed. So we have one story which is like, oh, it's a fun thing for people to do in university, and then we have one story about like, no, the people that use it are bad and they're gonna go into crime. And I'm really interested in how we change the story, because I don't think the law is enough. I think there's other things that we need to do, and I'm really curious how we do that.
Well, I will say something that I agree. The first, when I was preparing for this thing, I thought, we need a Netflix movie. Public opinion changes when there is a human face to it. It's really hard. I mean, we can have the most rational discussion here, and next week I'll go back to question period. You know? And the debate will be about polarizing debates, creating the wedge issue, and trying to move this debate. So it's very important that we continue to have good data, good facts, so that the reasonable adults can take it down. But we all have a responsibility in terms of ensuring that public opinion is cognizant of data and also creates some, evolves in its discussion. And sometimes the arts, the public is what changes. I mean, I would say, besides smoking, that is a big public, gay marriages is another of the things that came very quickly, and it's when people had started having gay marriage and having being visible on TV and coming out. So there may be a way in which people come out and say, well, yeah, it's not a big deal, and let's move on. I've been smoking, and instead of being like Bill Clinton that it didn't inhale, people admitting to inhaling or something. I don't, like, there is a way in which you have to create a discussion where you, and it's tough. When it was criminal, it creates a story comes with it, a stigma is attached to it. Now that you've moved beyond this, it will take a while before the stigma disappears.
I would definitely say, think about smoking, in the consumption context, mm-hmm. leaving the important issues around same-sex marriage aside for the moment. I mean, think of what happened with smoking. Think back to your parents' time. And smoking was cool. It was sexy. If you didn't do it, you were kind of out of it. Ashtrays were ubiquitous, right? I always, when I talk about smoking, I say, consider the ashtray and its fate. And what I mean by that is, what got us to the public health success story of smoking, I think, was the sort of interplay between shifting public attitudes and regulation. The more that we regulated appropriately, because it's always appropriate, the more we help nudge public attitudes away from smoking being glamorous to a filthy habit. The more people thought, ooh, smoking, ugh, the more that opened the door for more regulation. With cannabis, it's going to be the other way around, right? We've now legalized it, so as Natalie says, that's helping to remove the stigma, and the more that there's usage, moderate usage, people can use this, and we will need to protect young people. It becomes kind of normalized. But I'm prepared to say not too normalized, right? Like there's, it's not a harmless drug.
Yeah.
It's like alcohol. There are real downsides. And I know we haven't got the impaired story right. Let me talk to you about the Dreiger 5000. I've done more interviews with the Dreiger 5000 than I care to mention. So we've got real problems about accuracy. We want accuracy in apprehending drug-impaired driving. Nevertheless, we've got to get at that one because we have a horrible record of impaired driving in this country, certainly in terms of alcohol. We have the greatest percentage of fatalities associated with alcohol and motor vehicle accidents in the world. So we've got a lot of work to do. So, it's stories that kind of go on simultaneously, like people shouldn't be stigmatized, they shouldn't be definitely criminalized for use. On the other hand, we shouldn't think, oh, it's completely cool and there's never a downside, and of course, if kids are using it, oh, well, they're just being kids. I think we have to, for example, develop a very sophisticated education piece around kids and cannabis. Like way more sophisticated than just say no.
I do think, just like 30 seconds, that as the baby boomers start to be more truthful and open about their use, and not just like smoking it, but like now, of course, like vaping, and then in whatever edibles they're going to have, as well as oils and things like that, I think that'll serve to normalize in a sense.
Yeah, I have to say again, I'm much more worried about the opium epidemic than about cannabis. You know, the cannabis is, it's kind of a walk in the park compared to opium and what it is.
The follow-up, a practical question by Sarah Streben, who is a question related to to driving. Sarah, no? Okay. She's not in the room. Then I have Sherry.
Yeah, everyone sort of touched on this a little bit about the inconsistency in the enforcement application that it currently exists or has existed in the criminal system. And you talked about the effects of that inconsistent enforcement on sort of like job security, income security, housing. I'm curious how you see sort of legal frameworks and the effects of that on other legal decision-making, specifically in family law, if any of you have that expertise. So there, as a result of the fact that there's inconsistent application of criminalization, then there's that, has this step further into sort of custody issues, child support, those kind of decisions, and how do we go about reversing those decisions that have already been made and already have had permanent consequences on the sort of very deeply personal lives of people and their relationship with their children and their families. Like, is there a way to sort of build into the regulatory scheme a framework for addressing those legal consequences outside of criminal law?
Well, that's why when I talk about the triggering effect of law reform, it's once you open up a category, it used to be illegal, now it's legal. It has a radiating effect on all sorts of aspects that had been buried. You know, it eliminates, it shines a little bit of a light on maybe the way in which judges would make very quick decisions on whether someone was a user in determining whether he or she should have access to her children or have custody or so on. So all of this is part of the transition, and there's some lessons learned too about, have we been too rigid in assessing the way in which the criminal convictions are the epitome of being the bad citizens, that's part of the jury as well, that you should never, because you have a criminal conviction, you should never sit on a jury. 25% of people will have a criminal conviction of some time. So, it's why, they've paid their debt, why is it that we continue to do that? So I think it's a good question. I see lots of potential for good legal research and good papers to advance a little bit our thinking. It probes different issues, and deeper questioning.
Can I just say, I totally agree with Natalie, though. What I would say is on a slightly optimistic note. We went through this with gambling about 50 years ago. Like, up until the late 60s, to gamble in this country was a criminal offense. And in the late 60s, we legalized and regulated gambling, and the provinces had a role, and the feds had a role, and in the last 50 years, we've continued to shine lights on various implications, and it hasn't been easy. But I think it's unimaginable now that we would think that we would prosecute somebody for gambling. It just has, it's moved, it has a different story now. We still have impaired use. We've got it down to about 3%. There are ways that we can get it down even further if the government would be brave. we've been through this actually quite recently, and it certainly has had complications, and I think your question's really a very good one, but it's not like oh my God, there's no pathway here. You know, we're taking a gigantic step off a cliff and we're all going to crash at the bottom. I think that's not going to happen.
Mm-hmm.
This might apply more to Kwasi and Natalie than it does to Mr. Robert, but so I remember the 2016 carding legislation, which was, I guess, like a direct attack on the stop and frisk policy that obviously seriously affected minority populations, specifically the Black Canadian community. And I was curious about your opinion on sort of like legislating to counteract effects that come about because of other policies that are in place or attitudes that you can't really legislate out of people, but we're trying to do that. And maybe that as an example, and then if you think that that sort of action is successful or if it's something that needs to be more endemic in society, or that, to speak to that.
You start.
Yeah, that's a tough question. As far as I'm concerned, oftentimes these kind of like legal and criminal justice reforms are trying to solve problems at the back end of a system instead of the front end, right? And so they're of limited utility without a doubt. I do think there needs to be some measures taken to kind of reduce some of these disparate impacts, right? And so regulations over carding, some of the things that I've proposed would be useful, but of course, it's funny, I finished my PhD, I started as a professor of criminology, I'm like, why didn't I go into education? Because all the problems that I'm dealing with could have been more effectively dealt with if we had a better education system. And so I recognize that, yeah, like a lot of this is not going to be dealt with in the criminal justice system, but there's still work that can be done there.
I agree with you. I think the good thing about this legislation was to highlight and protect somehow, change some policies. Now there is a review, of it, because the minute that you put that, people come and says, oh, it's way too severe, way too rigid, we can't police anymore, So Justice Tulloch is doing another review to see how to fine tune it. It will always happen that, you have kind of a public policy issue and it shouldn't happen. Let's just deal with it. And that's why we need good research.
Mm-hmm.
So that we actually, when there's the opportunity for action, we know what to do. Mm-hmm. And good law reform should be about that. I don't know how many law reform books or reports I did, but we know that eventually, there'll be a crisis, there'll be an opening in the public discourse to arrive with it, And that's why I think, like your research, permit but discourage, that's a word that I actually use all the time. And, how are we going to make sure that we evaluate what are the good tools that we have to permit but discourage, and what works, which ones have perverse effects, and how do we get more nuance, more adept at going forward. So, carding is a perfect example. There's different ways in which you would have wanted to respond. It could have, a constitutional case, legislation, training for police officers to recognize different policies of hiring, whatever, sometimes the options get crystallized. And sorry, I don't want to go too far on this, but just there's a great article about the way in which in the States, when we started having the motorcycle helmets, there was too many accidents and they were choice. You could reduce the speed, you could change the way in which roads were, or you could demand that motorcyclists wear a helmet, And eventually all the other options were limited because everybody chose the helmet, And eventually the answer would be, are you for or against safety on the road? Well, if you're for, it's helmet, whereas there was lots of other options that became narrow. So and that's something that we should, as public policy developments, we should always think is you can, when it's going to be in the political forum, it's going to be narrow between two options. But, our job is to constantly evaluate whether there are other things that could have been done and that would be more effective or not.
I still have questions by Hartley and Karen. Do you feel that your questions were answered? Or?
I have a different question, actually, which kind of flows from that, which is, I'm wondering what you think legalizing so-called harder drugs actually looks like in practice, because I think a lot of people can get behind
decriminalizing. But I think, and you allude to this, Professor Bogart, like the idea that your kid could walk up to a dispensary and buy acid from the government, I think is like a very stigmatizing idea. So I'm wondering how that actually might work in practice.
That's a very good question. And it, you know, if you have time to read the chapter in Off the Street on supply, you'll see that I struggle with it, and I really take to task really notable think tanks like Transform in England and the Global Commission on Drugs, whose work I really respect and I recommend to you. I mean, they're thin on details about how would this actually work. So acknowledge and admit that. I think what will happen is, you know, to take your issue about, it'll be jagged, it'll be a little bit of this, a little bit of that. But there are two things that I think are pathways. One is decriminalization is a first step. So we at least clear away the notion that you're going to be criminalized for simple possession or use. Okay? And a lot of health advocates, in terms of the opioid crisis will say, and the additional benefit will have a destigmatizing effect. We'll get more people who come forward to use the safe injection sites, get other forms of help. Okay? But I think the other thing that's happening with the opioid crisis, this terrible plague, is it is actually giving us a pathway to what legalization might look like. Because if you put decriminalization together with the various innovations that are going on in terms of health reduction, like the safe injection sites and the presence of medical grade heroin, if we push forward with that on the opioid front, we'll almost get to legalization, very strictly controlled legalization, right? Because on the demand side, people will not be arrested, prosecuted. And on the supply side, they'll be getting their drugs under very strictly regulated conditions on either through safe injection sites, because that's the next step we'll have to make. We'll have to make the drugs available. Right now, people have to bring their own drugs and then they're tested, etc. Or they'll get them through medical grade heroin, or they'll get them through this very interesting experiment that's going on by the British Columbia Center on Disease Control. They're putting hydromorphone into dispensary machines, which is, you know, you think like, oh my God, that's just such a wild thought. But this is actually being done. And again, we're going to have to study the effects and the impacts. But so the opioid crisis, the silver lining of this terrible plague, is just pushing us forward. Now, you know, I can't tell you what cocaine and crystal meth will look like, but I don't think it's beyond the notion that at some point these things will be available in a pharmacy. People will be warned of the dangers. But the other thing I think we have to take, like, not everybody takes drugs is dependent on them, right? People do take drugs for pleasure. Like, it is possible to use cocaine and not become dependent. I don't use it, I don't recommend it, but I think we have this terrible, terrible apprehension that, oh my God, if you do a line of cocaine, your life's over. And so I think we have to kind of get beyond that, and while at the same time discouraging, right? I'm sorry to quote myself, but it is permit, but discourage. The solution does not lie in the criminal law. The solution lies, as difficult and complicated it is through the lens of public health. We have to go over here, as difficult as that is.
But in the context of the opioid crisis, there is a complicating factor. It's not just available in pharmacies right now. It's controlled through prescription. And a big problem has been the fact that there is a huge impact of marketing on the physicians who prescribe it. So it's the intermediaries who contribute to the crisis. So we have to stop you, but I think it's not as easy to apply as in the context of marijuana. People don't necessarily take it for for recreational use, they get addicted because they suffer pain and they get it through prescription.
No, I don't think I ever used the word easy, Trudeau. I've never used the word easy. But I'm suggesting how you handle it once it's occurred.
Yeah. Okay, so we have to stop, but I invite you to... Seminar is on Thursday, October 4th. Don't be for the conference. We'll be speaking about the title on the program is Stem Cell Research, Morality in the Law, but we'll actually talk about assisted human reproduction and issues related to privacy and in the context of South African case law, but applicable or interesting to apply in the Canadian context. So you'll get more details through email. So, October 4th.
You maintain your position.
Thank you.
Well, thank you, Joe. I really appreciate the opportunity.